At 2 o'clock in the morning on July 23, 1919, Johnny Brown was jolted out of bed after a fitful, sleepless night. Brown, a Salvation Army convert turned traveling preacher, rose and declared, "I'll build that school." That school was John Brown University, and build it he did, in a cornfield on the western edge of Arkansas, in a town called Siloam Springs. That school would be guided by one foundational belief, Christ over all. Construction began that August. In September, before the first building was even completed, 70 students and 10 instructors arrived on campus. From the very beginning, John Brown University was different than other academic institutions. With an emphasis on vocational training, it was a place that was preparing young Christian men and women of any means for a life of public service.
Education, to be education, must train the hand as well as the head and the heart.
JBU would be a place to learn, but also a place to worship and work. Head, heart, and hand, as it's become known, would be forever grafted into JBU's identity. JBU would slowly but surely mature from a junior college into a vibrant, accredited, four-year evangelical university.
I think the founder did have a tremendous inspiration in bringing about this institution, getting it started.
The university began adding professional programs in broadcasting, engineering, and education. An intercollegiate athletic program was added as well. A library, a science building, and the Cathedral of the Ozarks were completed and became the academic center of the university. Finally, with the implementation of a liberal arts core curriculum, the university secured accreditation in 1962. Cultural shifts brought changing styles and new opportunities, but JBU remained true to its spiritual identity.
The mission of educating the head, heart, and hand has been intact for 100 years. The ideal of Christ over all has been intact. And I think that's one of the great strengths of John Brown University.
Student enrollment exceeded the goal of 1,001 by 91, and academics continued to flourish throughout the decade with the establishment of an honors program, a degree completion program for adults, and the graduate school. The new millennium brought with it 21 major building and renovation projects, and by 2018, the endowment topped $120 million in assets.
JBU has become a world-class university, in my opinion, no doubt.
God would prove faithful to JBU, and JBU proved faithful to carry on the founding motto, Christ over all.
The educational philosophy can change in its shape and the way it looks, but Christ over all hasn't changed at all. In fact, I think we're as faithful or more faithful than we've been throughout our history. And for me, that's the most important thing.
To say a lot has changed at JBU in the past century would be an understatement. But to say a lot has not changed would be even more true. Although our buildings may look different, our faculty may engage in teaching, scholarship, and service in new ways, our staff may have jobs unheard of 100 years ago, and our students come from more distant lands, yet we are still that school, built on the foundation of Jesus Christ and guided by one simple belief, Christ over all.
When we cry out in our confusion and pain and hurt, And when you do not immediately grant the prayers of our cries, we begin to doubt that you even care or even exist. Stop us from going down this path of self-destruction. Help us look around and find the many ways in which you have blessed our lives. Forgive us when we are so quick to doubt and so arrogant in our demands of your responses. This day, give us a spirit of patience and willingness to be ready to hear your voice. Strengthen us for the ministries of love and hope that you have placed before us. For we ask this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Oh.
morning, church. Good morning. Welcome to online worship. My name is Pastor Bob Demyanovich, and I am the pastor here at Cass City United Methodist Church. Now you know what's next. Look at your family member. Look at your children. Look at your beloved pet and say, I am glad that you are here. Now look at someone else and say, God loves you, and there's nothing you can do about that. Good morning. We're on the beautiful campus here of John Brown University in Siloam Springs, Arkansas. Behind me is the Cathedral of the Ozarks and this beautiful, beautiful fountain, which has the inscription of John 7, 37, 38. We welcome you here this morning with us. When Jesus left his disciples, he gave us a promise. I will not leave you orphaned. For we, his disciples, live in him, and he in us. The presence of God within and all around. What a promise. Take courage. Take comfort. Blessed be God. Because Jesus Christ is in us, and we in him. His peace is a powerful gift, and we may share with others. Pass the blessing of this peace to your family, your children, your brothers and sisters, and to all the children of God. Blessed be to God. We welcome Carla C. Ringheiser as this week's liturgist, right here on this campus.
Please direct your attention to the screen for our call to worship. The Lord has been our refuge and our keeper.
It is God who has kept us from falling and saved our lives.
Let our thanks and praise resound throughout this place of worship.
Let our love and gratitude be shown in all that we do.
Open your hearts and spirits to God this day.
Lord, be with us and place your hand of healing in our lives. Amen.
Holy.
Today's scripture reading is from the New Testament book of Luke, chapter 10, verses 25 to 37. And this is the New International Version. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life? What is written in the law?" Jesus replied, "How do you read it?" The man answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." "You have answered correctly," Jesus replied. "Do this and you will live." The man wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" In reply, Jesus said, "A man going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. 'Look after him,' he said, 'and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have.' Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers?" asked Jesus. The expert in the law replied, "The one who had mercy on him." Jesus told him, "Go and do likewise." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Wonder what kind of impact you have on your family, on your friends, or people in general? Do you stop to consider how your life matters in this world? Life is precious, especially now during this crisis. It is a gift from God, and every one of us matters to someone. But sometimes I stop and wonder if I am making my life count. Am I making the most of my opportunities to bless others? Am I making an impact? Don't you wonder the same sometimes? As a pastor of a church, it is my responsibility to evaluate whether we are a body of believers and are making an impact on our community as well. You see, the job of the church is not to impact the church, but to impact the world around us. It's like a huddle in a football game. 60,000 people don't pay $129 a ticket to watch the Detroit Lions huddle. What if you went to a Lions game and for the next 2.5 hours you just watched these 11 men sit in a circle and talk? That's not what you paid $129 for. What they want to know is, what play are they calling? What secret signals are they making? Does it work? Will they score a touchdown? So the challenge for our church is not what we do when we call our Sunday morning huddle online, but what we do when we break the huddle and head to our weekday assignment. When life struggles and things line up against us, what difference does it make that we are Christian? This has been on my mind for some time, and I wonder if it's just me. As I search my heart and the Bible for answers, it was the story of the Good Samaritan, the spirit that impressed me. We have heard the story 1,000 times. It's been analyzed to death. We know who the bad guys are. I will not dissect the story entirely, but we'll pull out the critical questions to answer. How can we impact our neighbors with the love of Jesus? What must we do to inherit eternal life? When women share their problems with their husbands, how do men typically respond? Men respond by saying, "This is what you should do." Or they try to do it themselves. Now, in our enlightened age, we men should know by now that the woman was not sharing her problems for us to solve them. All she wanted us to do was listen. But ingrained in all of us is this compulsion to do. How can I impress God so that I may gain eternal life? What must I do to get eternal life? Jesus responds in his characteristic teaching by throwing the question right back at me. You are a student of the law. What do you think the law tells you to do? The law expert responded, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as you would love yourself." Then Jesus says, "Do this, and you will live." There is a hint of mirth in Jesus' reply. He knows, and the expert in the law knows, that it's impossible to keep 2 commandments perfectly. It is unfortunate that he is asking about a way of life instead of a way of life. There is an important difference here. We think, even with our knowledge of God's grace, that there is something that we can do to be significant, to avoid a wasted life. If I keep busy enough, if I do enough, then maybe. Doing is important, but there is something more to making an impact. Being shaken by the challenge to love God and neighbor, the expert in the law tried to ease his conscience, knowing that he had not loved every person equally. And he asked, "Who is my neighbor?" Then he asked, "Who is my neighbor?" I want to answer this in a practical and personal way. You know who the neighbor is in the story, but who is your neighbor? Who is your neighbor in this COVID-19 crisis? If I think of my neighbors literally in Cass City, I would have to say it's Ron and Beth Kittle. It's Susie and Ed Stoutenberg. It's Keith and Jane Mitchell. It's Julie Janet. It's Gary and Doris Jones. It's Gerald Auten. It's Connie Schwarterer. It's Kathy and Roy Kentucky. But Bob and Barb, Pam and Morris, all of these people either go to our church. My neighbors are all churchgoers. So in a sense, we return to the original problem, that if I or you want to have impact, we are not to impact the church, but we should seek to impact our community. But my neighbors are mostly the church, as so are many of yours. Yet there are people near us, even among us in our neighborhood, who, like the man who went down to Jericho and was attacked by robbers, they stripped him of his clothes. They left him half dead. The fact of the matter is that these neighbors are dying spiritually. They're naked, they're wounded, and they're alone. They are discouraged with life, and no wonder if anyone cares. No wonder do they think God cares. The reality is that Jesus knows that kind of pain. He was stripped of his dignity. He was beaten and wounded. He was abandoned by his friends and God, knowing loneliness on the cross till he died. Jesus is more like them than like us healthy Christians. But they did not know him. In the movie The Four Feathers, a white Christian gets lost in the African desert while trying to save some friends. Thirsty, hungry, and stranded, he despairs and collapses onto the hot sand. When he wakes up, he realizes that a big, strong Muslim fellow had rescued him and is restoring him to health. The Christian asks why, and the Muslim replies, "Because God has put you in my path." Who is my neighbor? Is the person God puts in your path today? Your neighbor is anyone who needs, that you see, and anyone's needs that you are able to fulfill. What does a good neighbor do? We know that the priests and the Levites were not good neighbors. They ignored the plight of someone who was directly in their path. What would a good neighbor do? Obviously, the Samaritan is a model of true neighborlessness. Consider his actions. He took notice when he saw him. He took pity on him. Everybody saw the victim lying on the side of the road. He must have been hard to miss. Blood on the road, evidence of a scuffle, a leg protruding from the bush. Let's face it, you can all see when someone is hurting. On my way to Arkansas last week, we stopped for gas in Rama, Missouri. And it was raining, and while we were getting some gas, I could see a man sitting on the ground about 50 feet away from this station. He was all bundled up in his rain gear. He had his sleeping bag, his backpack, and he had a little sign that he was holding up. And all it said was, "Please help me." It was a busy street corner where the gas station was, and a lot of cars came back and forth. So while I'm getting my gas, I walked over to him and gave him some money. I asked him if he was okay, and he said that he was. And then we prayed for a moment. Not everyone takes pity on those in pain. A good neighbor notices and is moved to his heart or to her heart to reach out. I wish I could have done more. He got his hands dirty. He went to him and bandaged the wounds, pouring on oil and wine. As soon as he touched the man, he got involved. There was no turning back here. He was personally inconvenienced. Then he put the man on his own donkey. He walked so the man could ride. He paid a price. He took 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper. The sacrifice can be costly. It may cost you money, time, or even reputation to be a friend to a wounded person among us. Our church is Cass City, United Methodist. To the community of Cass City, we are the under-shepherds and called to go out and gather sheep that have wandered away and guide them back to the kingdom. Our work is to help Jesus change hearts that have been damaged by the negative aspects of our culture. The problem is that the church that fails to change fails to impact the culture of change. It becomes a dinosaur, a memorial to a world that no longer exists. So on the one hand, while it protects those within the walls from overwhelming stress, on the other hand, it becomes biblically and spiritually irrelevant. That which is to be the salt of the earth turns tasteless, and its light flickers dimly, if at all. To make an impact in our community and leave a lasting and effective impression for Christ means that we must open church again very soon. It may mean getting a little dirty with the problems around us. It means trading church culture for life-changing faith. It means building relationships outside of our usual circles and bringing in new faces, new families, and new attitudes to the church. We will be given a second chance very soon. Some of us will be afraid to return. The elderly, the ones with underlying health conditions, the ones that feel, I will wait this out until the fall. The question is this. Do you want to make an impact on others? Christ. The time is coming. And Jesus.
No, we do well now to conform with all that God requires.
When wilt thou save the people, O God of mercy, when? The people, Lord, the people, not thrones and crowns, but men. Flowers of thy heart, O God, are they? Let them not pass like weeds away. Their heritage, a sunless day. God save the people. Shall crime bring crime forever? Strength aiding still the strong? Is it thy will, O Father, that men shall toil for wrong? Oh, now say thy mountains, now say thy sky. Man's clouded sun shall brightly rise, and songs be heard instead of sighs. God save the people.
red. The people, Lord, the people, not thrones and crowns.
Lord of love, you have asked us to keep your commandments. In your life, you demonstrated the power of love to effect healing, redemption, and hope in our lives of all your people. Yet we are so unsure of your gifts that you have given us for ministry, and we wonder if you can really do what you want us to do. We are a strange mixture, Lord. We are arrogant in our demands of your mercy and timid in our awareness of the blessings and gifts you have given us. That is why we are here today. We really want to sense your presence and receive courage, truly, to be your people in this world that you have loaned us. Please keep Dick Wallace's mother in our prayers as she recovers from the COVID-19. Dorothy Manti, who's in the hospice. Bill Tucky, who's undergoing tests. Steve Forbear, who's going through chemo. Sue Johnston, who fell and is healing. Kathy and Phil Nichols, as Kathy is healing. Cheryl Seeley and Ed Prophet and Judy Prophet. Bob and Barb Wood, Bob and Barb Tucky. Jack Burns and their son Darren, who is back to work. Phil and Shirley Zinniger, as Shirley recovers from a fall. We pray for Pastor Jeff Nelson, baby Evan James Russell, and continue prayers for Charles and Iris Tuffy, Sandy David, and Linda and Daly Parrish. We pray for our congregation, including our shut-ins, that cannot get regular visits from their family or their church family. Also pray for the doctors, nurses, EMT workers, police, janitors, the grocery store workers, and the delivery workers, postal workers, and health care providers. Remind us that we bring names and circumstances before your throne of grace, that we also bring our own needs and our own concerns. Lay your healing hands upon our hearts and our spirits. place our lives and our trust in you, O Lord. Amen.
The sun cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne, before the Holy One of Heaven. It's only by your blood, and it's only through your mercy, Lord, I come. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne, before the Holy One of Heaven. It's only by your blood, and it's only through your mercy.
Lord, I bring an offering.
in the love of Jesus Christ. Now go into the world with the healing love of God to be given generously in peace and hope. God's peace will always be with those who live in God's love. Service has ended. Watch in peace and share this service with many others. You are blessed. And God does love you. And there's nothing you can do about that. Amen.